Europa, Ganymede, Enceladus. All moons in our solar system with one thing in common. They're suspected to contain liquid water below their icy surfaces.
And even further out, we have some tantalizing evidence that maybe worlds around Neptune, and potentially even Uranus as well, could host liquid water. Even Pluto might have a layer of liquid water hiding somewhere underneath that icy crust.
Experts think that if there is life beyond Earth, these massive oceans are the place we're most likely to find it in our solar system.
NASA scientists and oceanographers are working towards missions that hopefully will end up looking for and hopefully finding some forms of life, which may be very different from ours, on those other planetary bodies.
There's an increasing number of missions and proposals to explore these untapped water bodies, starting with an expedition to one of Jupiter's moons. It's called the Europa Clipper mission.
The Europa Clipper mission is NASA's next foray into the Jupiter system, and we're going to search for all of these amazing indicators of habitability and potentially life at Europa. Exploring our solar system's subsurface water oceans is one of the next big steps in space exploration.
In 1977, during a mission to photograph the barren volcanic floor along the mid-ocean ridge, scientists found something that totally changed our understanding of where life can exist.
They collected 3,000 photos of the seafloor, developed the film on board the ship, and as they were going through the footage, which was very boring because it was just barren volcanic rock, they came across 13 photos that had pictures of large clams in them. Shortly after that, the deep submersible Alvin that takes people to the bottom of the ocean arrived on the scene and dived on those sites and found the oases of life amidst all sorts of shimmering water that was clearly emanating out of the seafloor.
The seawater percolating into the seafloor was being heated by magma and then rising to discharge as hydrothermal vents. And those vents were supporting a previously unknown ecosystem. Before then, it was thought that most animal life depended on energy from the sun.
If you move more than about 50 to 100 meters away from a vent, the seafloor is barren. And the question is, how do these vents support the life? Well, clearly photosynthesis, on which most of our life relies on our planet, won't work at the bottom of the ocean because it's dark, and so there's no sunlight. So that photosynthesis will not be operative. However, we do have these gases that contain a lot of energy. And because of that, there are bacteria living around these areas and other microorganisms that are able to extract energy from those gases and use it to produce organic matter.
And that matter feeds an array of exotic animals.
When I first saw them, my mind was blown at several things. One, how beautiful they are, but also how big some of the animals are. Some of the creatures that you see down there are tube worms that can grow 6 to 10 feet long, foot-long clams, big mussels, and in fact, the diversity around these vents has been likened to that of the diversity of a tropical rainforest.
This discovery has big implications for planetary bodies in the universe with water, regardless of whether or not they're close enough to harness the energy of their host star.
It suggests that there's the possibility that there might be life on other planetary bodies that have water. And so, in some ways, this discovery is helping change our ideas about the potential for life on other planets.
In the decades since the hydrothermal vent discovery, evidence has piled up for oceans in the outer solar system. Both the Galileo probe that visited Jupiter and the Cassini probe that visited Saturn were equipped with an onboard device called a magnetometer, which was able to give substantial evidence for liquid oceans.
Think of it as like a fancy compass. Basically, any liquid water ocean, if it has salts in it, it can conduct electricity. And that means that if you have a world nearby, like Jupiter or Saturn, that has its own magnetic field, they can influence each other. And we can pick that up with a magnetometer. So this is how Galileo was able to provide tantalizing evidence of liquid water oceans around Europa and a couple of other moons in the Jovian system.
But life, as far as we know, needs more than water. There needs to be an energy source like the sun or similar processes that create hydrothermal vents. So when the Voyager mission flew past Jupiter's moon Io in 1979 and witnessed volcanic plumes, scientists were thrilled to confirm that these frozen bodies were more active than previously thought.
So we thought that the further out we got from the sun, the less interesting the solar system would be. Boy, were we wrong. Europa is far away from the sun. It's 5 times farther than Earth, and that means that it's much colder. Europa should be frozen solid, but it's not. Why is that? Well, we think that there are 2 reasons. The first is heat that's generated by radioactive elements in Europa's core. This is similar to how Earth's interior stays molten and really hot. As certain elements decay, they give off some heat. But we don't think that could be enough. The other thing that we think is keeping Europa warm is something called tidal heating. Now, this happens because as Europa orbits around Jupiter, its orbit is not a perfect circle. Instead, it's a bit of an ellipse. And that means when Europa is orbiting Jupiter, sometimes it's a little bit closer, sometimes it's a bit further away. And so the moon actually goes like this. And that tidal flexing generates heat, just as if you were to, you know, rub your hands together, you'd generate some heat due to that friction. So we think that that also is helping to keep Europa's ocean liquid, potentially for a very, very long time.
Tidal heating is also the reason for the volcanic activity on Io observed by Voyager. But there are other reasons for making Europa the top priority. While some moons in our solar system have many craters, Europa has few. And this means that the surface is probably very young, due to an ocean that causes the surface to warm and crack, changing the landscape and erasing craters.
Based off of what we know of Europa now, we know it has a liquid water ocean. We know it has some building blocks that could potentially be used for organic molecules to make life. And we know it has an energy source. So all of these lines of evidence point towards having the ingredients for life. Not only that, but this intense tidal heating could lead to hydrothermal vents down at the seafloor of Europa. And so this is why it's at the top of our list to study as a world that could host life of its own.
Now all we need to do is get there.
Europa Clipper is prepared to launch in 2024. We have really amazing cameras that are going to take higher resolution images than ever before. We've got some imaging spectrometers. These are instruments that'll be able to tell us what the composition of the surface is. We'll have a magnetometer, a fancy compass, to be able to understand more about Europa's interior ocean. We'll even have a radar sounder so that we can look for near surface water reservoirs too. In addition to that, we're going to have a few other particles and fields instruments to try to understand the plasma environment. All of those ions that are zipping around in the Jupiter system, we'll be able to understand those because they're important too.
Color and infrared cameras will map the surface and search for hotspots where material from within Europa, possibly the ocean, may reach the surface. It will be the first mission sent to specifically study a moon other than our own. The mission will place the Clipper spacecraft, which is longer than a basketball court, in orbit around Jupiter, where it will perform about 40 flybys of Europa.
Now, ideally, we would love to send Clipper and go straight into orbit around Europa, but the conditions in the Jovian system don't make that the best option for us. There's a bit of radiation that's right in and around where Europa sits in orbit around Jupiter. And while that's not necessarily bad for life, in fact, it could make some molecules and some ions that might be good for life, it's not so good for our spacecraft. So instead, we are planning on doing flybys of Europa, where we go in, we get our data, we get out and cool off for a bit, send that data back to Earth, and it gives us, as scientists, plenty of time to look over things before the next pass.
The spacecraft may even be able to sample particles high above Europa's surface. During past Earth observations, and observations from the Hubble Space Telescope, scientists have seen something that looks like plumes of water or other material on Europa. Clipper will be equipped with the right tools, and will be able to fly close enough to analyze those plumes if they do indeed exist.
This would be similar to Saturn's moon Enceladus, where free sample from its ocean is actively venting into space. Now this would be really exciting for us because some of the instruments aboard Europa Clipper could collect some of those ice grains if they're there or some of the gases and be able to tell us what they're made of and help us get a glimpse of the composition of that ocean.
Although the main goal of Clipper is to understand habitability on Europa, not all of the questions regarding life can be answered from flybys. That's why NASA is proposing a follow-up mission to launch in the next couple of decades that could land on Europa.
The Europa Lander mission concept is something that we've been developing that could potentially visit a world like Europa or another ocean world one day. This concept could have some type of legs to be able to stabilize itself on a really treacherous terrain. And a lot of engineers are developing sampling tools that could cut into very, very cold ice.
The European Space Agency is also sending a probe in the next couple of years called the Jupiter Icy Moons Explorer, or JUICE. It will spend at least 3 years studying Jupiter and the habitability of three of Jupiter's moons, Europa, Callisto, and Ganymede, the last of which was recently found to have possible water vapor coming from its surface. And there are even more ambitious proposals to explore subsurface oceans in the far future.
There are even robotic snakes. There's one that's called EELS, the Exobiology Extant Life Surveyor. We love our acronyms at NASA. This is something that could slither down into cracks or crevices where biosignatures might be hiding, potentially protected from radiation. So there are all sorts of exciting concepts on the horizon. There are even like these hoppers that could even take some of that water ice and then melt it and use the steam to sort of puff, to bounce around, to go to different places.
Finding even microorganisms would undoubtedly change our understanding of life and the boundaries of the habitable zone, the area around a star which we think could support life as we know it.
Really, it's caused us to change our ideas for where we might look for life and how abundant habitable conditions might be in the universe.
Since many planets around other stars, known as exoplanets, are now thought to contain liquid water, these expeditions may tell us more about which of these planets are potentially habitable, and bring us closer to answering the age-old question of, are we alone?
Ever since we, as human beings, first started to look up and wonder about stars, about other planets, other worlds, we wondered if we were alone. You know, this universe is so vast, so immense, so amazing. Are there other worlds that could be, you know, more incredibly diverse beyond our wildest dreams and have life of their own? Or are we just incredibly, horribly alone? I hope it's the first one.